Madonna, Sheba, even Eve, dispelling Hollywood myths. I'm that truth you should believe in when the credits fade to black. Remember me, I'm woman.
All right, we're gonna move on to question number four. This comes from Katie. This is a lengthy one. So stay with me, ladies. Okay. Katie says, hi, here's my background. I am white, and I grew up in a very white suburb of Metro Detroit before moving to a slightly more diverse college town that prides itself on being progressive and aware, but still had issues with inequality and de facto segregation along the lines of race, socioeconomic status, etc. I've lived in Los Angeles for less than a year. As for my question, how has mental health intersected with your identity as a black woman, if at all? More specifically, mental health issues often face stigma within our society. Do you find that stigma is more or less pronounced for black women? So let's start with that first part. How has mental health intersected with your identity as a black woman? Brittany was ready.
No. So since I was younger, I've had anxiety, severe anxiety, but I was not diagnosed until recently. And I believe as black women, we have we're not allowed certain things. We're not allowed to be depressed. Mm-hmm. We're not allowed to have mental illness. I think everyone in the
black. You're not even allowed to blow up.
You're too angry. You're too bad. Yep. Yeah. And I suppressed it because I tried to be quiet. I tried not to get angry. I tried not to be all the things that the media said that was wrong with black women.
It's probably only more further enhances.
Exactly. Right. So, it enhanced so much to where it was I'm like, what is it like? I couldn't breathe. I mean, I felt like I was having a heart attack. And then I went to the doctor.
More like panic attacks where you're having.
Exactly. Mm-hmm. But, in addition to anxiety. And, even with medicine or going to therapy, it's always like, we got to pray it away. And I'm a prayer. I go to church. But I just feel like it's a stigmatism within our own community. I don't know if we do it to ourselves. Or what about being strong, or you're a man up, like both black women and black men. So
makes sense.
Mm-hmm.
You told me how it's affected you, how mental health affected you as a black woman. Patricia, how it's affected you.
I grew up in my parents are Nigerian. I grew up in a household where when they talk about what they endured and us being born here, there's nothing to really complain about. And not that they overtly ever said, you can't have issues, but it's just, you got it made here. So what is there to be, what is there to have issue about? What is there to have mental problem about? What is, you are eating? Because you have clothes on your back, you could eat, you could wake up, you had a house, you had a brain, you had your appendages. You're fine. You better make do with what you got, because you can only imagine what it would be like growing up in Nigeria. So anxiety, things like that, only really didn't come to realize that that's something anybody can have up until maybe within the last year or so. Mm-hmm. I've been talking openly about it with my friends. I also think that in general, I feel like we're not allowed to be crazy too. Mm-hmm. I kind of say that harshly, but we're not allowed to have issues. It's like, if there's a problem, it's because we did something wrong.
Yeah.
But if it were a white person, that's standard.
Or like we overreact.
We overreact. Yeah. It's like, you're not allowed to have issues. It's you did something wrong. You're misbehaving. You lashing out is,
or you're being lazy.
You're
depressed. You don't have a job. Yes. Oh, because you're lazy.
Yes. And they don't think, society doesn't think, it's something else. I'm telling you, I feel like black people, we're just there. And we don't get to have problems and have an explanation to the problem.
And we bought into it. So it's external.
Right.
We're doing it in our own household. Right. We'll say that too, though. We'll buy into it. Ain't no wrong with that girl. She just wants attention. You ever heard that?
Yes. Yeah.
Or
giving people the ministry of it, that people went and got good degrees in this stuff in the church. Let's pray about it, but send them to therapy.
Yeah, we can pray all day, but we still need send them to mental
care.
Health.
Right.
Mental health there.
But she just wants attention. I'll say that.
You're right. I've heard that.
It's really sad, though, because I see it in my family, and I don't think anyone.
have mental illness, but really severe mental illnesses, but I see it in my family, mm-hmm. and I see how, just in my extended family, how if they receive some type of help or just went to therapy or whatever.
Life-changing,
but I think they would have better relationships. Like, I mean, not to talk about my grandmother, she's never going to watch this, but my grandmother, like, is kind of can be very toxic. Mm-hmm. And I think a lot of women in her era, like, mm-hmm. in her age, can be have very toxic personalities towards other people because mm-hmm. they feel so threatened. Mm-hmm. And I feel like I see that in her children and my mother sometimes. But you see, it's just so crazy how you see if you can just go and get help for something for a very small issue, how to cope and deal and manage.
And it's normalized because she nailed it too.
It's normalized. And it's not something that maybe even is a chemical imbalance. It's just what you've been through mm-hmm. that you need to talk about. Mm-hmm. And because there's so many family secrets in my family, and there's so many things that we just don't talk about that can affect your offspring. Mm-hmm. I'm blessed because my mom's a social worker, so I've been to therapy. You know, I know that therapy is available. Exactly.
I'm not going.
But unfortunately, my mom, I don't think he's ever been to therapy, you know? And so it's really deep. It's really
stuff would
deep.
Happen, it would like deal with it. Or the whole, what happens in his house stays in his house. Mm-hmm. So yeah, tell them to a therapist was dead out.
Oh, you're telling our business.
Yeah. Right.
I went to therapy through our church. Okay. I went to therapy. It was a lot of childhood trauma. Not like, to me, it was like, oh, you know, nobody ever did nobody, you know, but it, to me, you never know how people internalize or do mm-hmm. things. Mm-hmm. And so talking to someone, because while you're a child, you can't tell your auntie, don't tell nobody what go on in this house, finally letting everything out and how I felt. And, you know, it like was a big weight taken. Mm-hmm. And my mom's a counselor too. That's the great thing. Mommy, sorry, but.
I've heard Ayana say, if you got the right on everybody, do what you got to do. Like, she was like, you got to save yourself.
But see, my mom promotes that. She promotes, like, go to therapy. And I think a lot, my counselor said, trauma, like child trauma. That's why a lot of people, it goes on and develops into bipolar disorder. Mm-hmm. Because they're trauma.
People are, the reason why the drug business is still a $1 billion business is because people have coped through those things instead of talking to someone, a professional,
like not someone you know involved, like an outside person, a mediator, someone who an unbiased person is not going to judge you, who's professionally trained to listen to you.
That's right.
And give you appropriate advice or whatever.
But this affects how we communicate, like, and how we live in this community of other Black people. So that's why it's like mental illness is so important. It's so important that we have mental illness for ourselves.
Because if you hide it away, it blows up into something some more severe that is almost untreatable.
I think most of the things that's plaguing us as a community is most likely mental.
Right.
We are still, I don't profess to know the terms, whatever, what to say, PTSD. I think we still have PTSD from slavery.
Yeah, totally. Oh, yeah. 100%. Yeah.
And so that hasn't even been lifted off. Right. So I think the most of the things, so it's affecting everything. I don't think most of even the marriages and the relationship mm-hmm. that we have are healthy.
Mm-mm.
Not at all.
And part of because we don't have a healthy sense of self.
That's right.
I mean, I feel like African Americans are lamenting from slavery and then the effects of slavery on your elders, mm-hmm. and then that trickles down.
It's generational.
It's definitely generational because if it affects how you live, financials, mm-hmm. you know, where you live, who raised you, like there's all these different factors and that trickle down. I have an aunt and an uncle that have mental illness. Two of my dad's siblings. You know, and they're the babies of their family out of 11 kids.
Mm.
And one thing I would just say is that I know mental health is so important, but I still think we have a long way to go as a culture for us all to get there. And when you feel down, you feel anxiety, don't sweep it under the rug. Don't try to just push through it. Don't try to sleep through it. Don't try to whatever. Go see somebody. But until then, I think we just, as Black people, have to just embrace each other. Because I can personally say that some of my family members are not as supportive of those that aunt and uncle that have mental illness. Mm-hmm. They shun them. Mm-hmm. They are annoyed by them, you know, and they're not able to work and live normal lives. They can't go to work like functioning adults. They have to be taken care of, you know. And they may call and be like, I need $50. Some relative are like, look, I just gave you $50 last month, you know, and not really being understanding to the fact of where they are mentally, that they can't cope and live as, you know, your average adult. And so I would just encourage everybody in the Black community to.
It's not kind.
Right. It's not kind, too.
Right, they're not.
And women, I think about my mom. Before she had the strokes and stuff, I think my mom was literally killing herself because she didn't deal with her mental. My mother has been abusing alcohol her whole life, right? And I guess if it wasn't for the stroke, what else would have taken my mom out? And she had all these episodes where she would just clown and just do the most ridiculous stuff, and it's gotten her arrested. I don't get very personal about it, but I'm about to make a point. But when I think about the trajectory of my mother's little life, right, her short life, she didn't have time to be in nobody's resort or retreat for a couple of months. Yeah. She had these three children,
yeah.
Right? And so she had whatever she was dealing with mentally, from whatever trauma that may have came from childhood or whatever, or the bad relationships and how we got here and how she's a mother, a single mother of three, mm-hmm. She did what she could, what she had. And so for this black woman, mm-hmm. at that time, there was no thousands of dollars lying around for her to be sitting around somebody's beach to get and sort and pick and stuff. Mm-hmm. So even the resources,
yeah.
or even yeah. that kind of mindset, it was just like, my mother would literally drink her hard liquor, pass that at night, and be back up at 4 o'clock in the morning to go to work, mm-hmm. leaving her two little daughters and latchkey kids, and then would work double shifts. That was her life, day after day, in and out, and then the men that filled the void and the need, that kind of thing.
Mm-hmm.
So that's my mother's life is not an anomaly.
if you walk past any little
black girl, young, we walk past them, we might, right. any little young black girl that's got two little girls, that's my mama,
yep.
circa 1988, you know what I mean?